Given all the fucked up things you've seen today, anything could be in there. You're a bit afraid to look. You have a hunch that perhaps the glass eye from upstairs might be in there. You take a breath and peer inside the tub. Sure enough, the eye's there, resting on what looks like some kind of pamphlet. And of course, fresh blood. Why blood? Ugh, this place just gives you the creep. Where is this blood even from? You shove the eye into your pocket and thumb through the pamphlet curiously, trying to avoid the blood spots. The first thing that catches your eye is a map of the church. It looks straightforward enough. Hopefully it will be as simple as it looks. You wonder where the second set of stairs on the ground floor goes. The map doesn't show a basement. As you peer at the map, you feel a resurgence of the strange feeling you felt in the hotel. The feeling of absolutely, without a doubt, knowing where you are in relationship with the map you just found. Out of all the strange phenomena you have encountered here, this one is almost the most disturbing. True, it's not actively trying to kill you, but somehow it's affecting your mind. How can you possibly have this information? You're on the second floor, that much is certain. You just came downstairs from the third, where the offices are. You take the eye out and turn it over in your palm. Something about it seems strange to you. Stranger than a lot of the creepy shit going around here. You nearly drop the thing as the iris swivels around. The eye is looking at something! In horror, you watch the iris spin around until it finally fixates on a single spot, peering off down the hallway. What is it looking at? Anything? Without quite knowing why, you follow the glass eye's gaze. Literally, you hold it out in front of you and walk. As you reach the end of the hall, the eye reorients, peering at the last door on the right. In front of you are the stairs, presumably to the ground floor. The door to them is closed. The eye stares fixedly at the red door of the last dormitory. You try to open the door, and it's locked. Of course, why do you expect anything different from this place? You rattle the knob in frustration, but it's no use. You'll need a key, or possibly a fish, or something equally stupid. It's been that kind of day. You get a hunch maybe the eye itself unlocks the door. However, you can't find any way to get the two to interact. Looks like that, isn't it? Take a smoke break. Yeah, it's definitely time for another cigarette. You don't even know how you went through the last one so fast. You smoked that sucker in like under a minute. You fish a cigarette out of your pocket. You take stock of the nonsense you filled your pockets with. Why in God's name are you carrying so much stuff? You feel smug when you realize you've had a key sitting in your pocket, but less so when you try and discover that it definitely doesn't fit this lock. Annoyed, you say sayonara to the stubborn, unyielding door that the eye had pointed to. If it's so damn important, you'll surely find another way in. You cross the hall and try its twin on the other side. Try the handle and find it opens easily. In your frustration, you decide to barge right in. And maybe you shouldn't have barged in after all. There's a corpse on the bed and blood everywhere. Before you check anything else in the room, you want to make absolutely sure that that thing on the bed is actually dead and not going to spring up and attempt to kill you. To that end, you decide the best method is to jab it with your wrench. You sidle gingerly up to the bed, keeping a sharp lookout for any sign of movement, and give the bloody hunk of meat a few sharp pokes. It just lays there. You feel equal parts relieved and disgusted. The body's starting to smell. There's a number of long, broad cuts across it, so it's been slashed repeatedly with a knife. Looks like there's something in its hand. If stealing from the dead is bad, and it is, then what you're considering now is definitely worse. Bus full of nuns worse. Besides, what if you don't even need it? You hardly have room in your pockets for all this crap as it is. You can't take a dead man's rosary. Wait, is that some kind of writing on the beads? You're probably gonna need that. You carefully use your wrench to lift the rosary out of its hand, trying to be as respectful as possible while performing such an action. You say the Our Father, and hope that he, and the victim, will forgive you for this. You are right, there's writing on the beads. Looks like a number. 5137. You commit the number to memory, repeating it so you won't forget. Afterwards, you gingerly lay the rosary back on the dead man. We pray to God that his spirit has departed. He's not somehow trapped in this awful place. After your moment of reflection, you turn and inspect the box you saw when you came in. You thought it had some kind of lock on it. When you check, you find that you're right. It's a combination lock, and you have a sneaking suspicion the number you memorized might be useful here. Unfortunately, like much of the room, the box is covered in congealed blood. It's going to be hard to keep your hands cleaner, but you better check what's in the box. You input the four-number string you just memorized into the lock, grimacing so the blood runs off on your fingers. At the end, you hear an encouraging click and the lid opens. It looks like you found the murder weapon. The dagger, stained with blood and deeply rusted, bears an image of a pomegranate on its hilt. You pick up the bloodied blade. It seems to be too rusted and too short to be of much use. You shudder to think what the guy in the bed must have gone through being slashed with a weapon like this. However, just because it's unlikely to make a useful weapon, doesn't mean you shouldn't take it. The fact that it was locked up like that, combined with the symbol on its hilt, makes you think you'll need it for something. The fact that it's marked with a pomegranate seems important. It also creeps you the hell out. You don't feel like anything good can come from a knife that's been used to commit murder. You just hope you can get rid of it as soon as possible. You tuck the dagger carefully away in your coat, wrapping in the veil just to be cautious. The blade is so dull it doesn't seem to matter, though. You go to check out the only other interesting thing in the room, the dressed mannequin with a priest's coat. You start to pat it down, in case there's anything in the pockets. Ow! You feel a stabbing pain in your finger as you search the coat. Something on it pricked you. A drop of blood wells up on your finger. The tiny wound hurts like hell, as they often do. You immediately stick it in your mouth in an animal reaction to pain. You taste the coppery drop of blood in your tongue. Angrily, you grab the coat off the dressing doll and shake it, trying to dislodge whatever pricked you. But you're having trouble seeing, and you feel a bit dizzy. Electricity seems to crawl under your skin. It's Halloween night. Your Uncle James, who's taking you trick-or-treating every year as long as you can remember, is now sick in bed. You went out by yourself tonight, since you're old enough. Your bag is now full of candy. You decide to make a surprise visit to your uncle's nearby apartment to cheer him up. You'd also like to show him the hard work you did on your costume. His apartment is around here somewhere, isn't it?